Thank you. Thank you very much, Alison, Simon, Burton. Thank you, everybody, for inviting me. It's been a great event, having a good time. So I'll tell you briefly through some perspectives in epidemiology that, although that implicit there are many experts here, they might not be completely aware. So the field of mathematical epidemiology with differential equations as we know it was essentially started by the medical doctors, particularly Sir Ronald Ross, who won the Nobel Prize for his work on malaria in 1902, was the second Nobel Prize awarded for that. And essentially, even though after he discovered the transmission process involved in the process of infection for malaria via this parasite, and that he knew that a good control measure was to bring the vector population below a particular below some threshold, he had to go to mathematics to make his case stronger. So in 1911, studying a tradition that is often found in mathematical epidemiology, in an appendix of a paper, he introduces this beautiful model, and it also introduces several concepts that have been used later on and often are not credited to him. So in this particular model, it's important because it's a mechanistic model. You see the role of host vector ratio, you see dividing rates, you see all those kinds of things. And for this, he's actually able to determine the dynamics of malaria. Then he gets into the topic of this conference when he actually asks the question, well, now that I know the process of transmission from person to person, what can I do for the public good? In other words, can malaria be controlled at the community, the population, regional, community level? And that's where mathematical models play a bigger role. So it is essentially a problem across the scales, because what he's trying to do is, how do I use individual transmission knowledge to explain disease patterns at the different levels of organization and over different spatial and temporal scales? And essentially, he uses mathematics to identify key quantities. That's where the mechanistic model become important, including the concepts of thresholds. And furthermore, in his paper, among other things, it's a really interesting appendix to read, he says, by the way, you can use this model to study sexually transmitted diseases just as well. So he does that only in that paper, studying and completing the field of mathematical epidemiology. It took about 60, 70 years before the late Ken Cook and Jim York actually follow through. And they write this beautiful paper using integral equations, where they actually applied these ideas to the study of gonorrhea transmission and control. Just in the area, this Herbert Heathcote and also Jim York produced the most interesting paper on sexually transmitted diseases in the 80s and probably for a long time, when they introduced the idea of the core group. And without data, this is important, they write a two-sex model involving heterogeneity, and through the idea that there is a small group of individuals that are capable of generating most secondary cases of infections, they conclude that everything that was being done at that time to identify and reduce the cases of gonorrhea was simply wrong. And people understand it, believe it, and if you go to the health clinics across the country, public health departments, they use the concept of the care group now to control gonorrhea. Essentially, every time there is an outbreak, they identify on this particular group, and they go and treat them and ask them, here you go again, who did you sleep with, and so on. Okay. There was another, in the 90s, there was another addition that followed through, and this was the work of Ed Kaplan at Yale, which in the 90s essentially uses again the same ideas of Ross and develops a model for the transmission dynamics of HIV via intravenous drug users. And he proposes, among other some people, a needle exchange program. So in fact, in order to model this process, he has to model two populations, a population of needles, and study the epidemics of HIV and needles, and the population of intravenous drug users. And through a very careful study in New Haven, he shows that his program would work and that actually would save, a program that costs about $150,000, that would save two lives in New Haven. But New Haven is small. Later on, people in New York City, including the mayor, that were skeptical, they invited him. He goes and makes his proposal there, and his program is implemented there, and it is believed that he saved 2,000 lives in New York City. So this is just an extraordinary example of something that can be done. And the big thing that Ed Kaplan had to do is to prove with others convincingly that having a needle exchange program was not going to increase the number of cases and increase the numbers of via intravenous drug use. And he did some careful studies, including some circularity theory, in order to address this. Okay, so let's go back now to communicable diseases, and I will go back and forth. So the most typical is the SIR model that has been described several times. And this general idea can also be used at different levels of organization. So at Los Alamos, there is a group that has been working for many years in modeling cities and modeling the movement of individuals between cities. And the main idea associated with modeling the movement of people between cities started in the late 60s during the oil embargo, when the general idea is how can we build more efficient cities so that we spend less gas and we conserve energy. But this model is there, this structure is there, so that has been used to try to model epidemic processes. So what they do is build cities. In this case, and they have done many. In this case, I'm going to highlight the city of Portland, where they have 180,000 locations. And they have 1.5 million people moving there. They conducted a survey that I believe cost $30 million, where they asked people what they do. So they asked Allison, at what time do you get up, and what do you do, who does this, who does that, the same thing, Nina, and so forth. And eventually, they built a series of schedules, and then they built a synthetic population, and they assigned these schedules to these individuals, and they discovered something incredible. That women do almost everything. No, well, they already knew that. But they developed this, and then they started to do that. And something happens that is absolutely different than I think that is worth noticing. Number one, real networks do not behave like scale-free networks or small world networks or anything like that. Networks are change over time. Something that we do regularly in dynamical systems when we model, for example, age-dependent processes, for example, epidemic. When you model the transmission dynamics of influenza and you consider age structure and interaction with the age groups, whether you use dynamical systems, differential equations, or partial differential equations, essentially you are constructing a network of interacting individuals with the additional advantage that you are not connecting two nodes by a fixed age, but actually you have a dynamic age that takes into account the dynamics of interacting groups. Well, in this case, you say, well, what about individuals? Well, the same thing happens. So in this particular network, assuming that there are no college students in Portland, at night, everybody's sleeping at home. As the day begins, people start to move to different places. So the nodes start to connect. As the nodes start to connect, the traffic between nodes starts to change and increase. So it eventually starts to build in a fully connected network in the middle of the day, but the traffic and the strength between nodes is essentially different. So this is the network that they use, and he had Scott Barrett coming to work to New York City in the morning. He has to get up very early so that he doesn't have traffic. And since we know everything at Los Alamos, where I spent a year as Ulan Scholar, they will know your salary, how much you make, everything. You know, Big Brother knows absolutely everything, so that is Scott coming to work. And what we have actually is been able to study these networks at different times. It's a huge network because you have 1.5 million people. So you can't just plot a histogram or anything like that. You have actually to sample the data and analyze that. And you can study this network conditioned on activities, conditioned on social activities, work-related activities, different kinds of activities. And as you do this, what you identify is different power laws, but they change over time. The coefficients change over time, and they are not of the standard class that one sees in scale-free networks and so forth. Anyway, since these networks already exist, you can actually study epidemics. And in this particular case, we're studying an epidemic again, the city of Portland. In the right-hand side, you have the situation where people go on an epidemic of influenza like nothing happened. And on this side, about 75% of the people try to avoid each other. And what is surprising is essentially you get the same curve that you get in the SIR model. And here this is where I have an issue, because I can fit that curve to any SIR model, and I could get a perfect fit. And my big question is, what the parameters would mean? What the parameters would actually tell me about that process? Very limited, because there is a lot of information encoded in the interactions between individuals in that community. So for example, one of the things that doesn't come in here, but most of the secondary cases of infection take place at homes, not at schools. The schools are critical nodes, but most of the secondary infections take place at home. And there is all sorts of information that when I could actually get from these ideas. I have been involved in the story of behavior. Simon mentioned something related to that. And the general idea is, and I'm gonna give a caricature here, but these are ideas that Eli Fenichel and Charles Perrins and others brought, and I got involved and I have gotten more and more interested. But the general idea is that I've been dealing with economists for a long time, trying to understand what they say, and I still can't. The only word that I learned over this place is, if I want to sound intelligent, I just have to say the word trade-offs. And they say, okay, you got it, Carlos. But the point is that people make decisions according to what they value, okay? So if for example, a single mother has a sick child in the morning and has to drop it at the daycare center, appears with temperature, often they bring the temperature down, they go to the daycare center, and leave the child. And then they go to work and say, somebody called me, I'm not here, you don't know where. And they wait, and 2 hours later, the kid has temperature, they try to find the parents, they don't. And by 3 o'clock, the mother shows up, I'm sorry, I didn't know, and because they can't afford to lose a day of pay. And that's the, and therefore they make decisions of that. I always make sure that in the middle of an epidemic influenza, for example, in Mexico, if people had a hot day, I'm sure they were not going to miss that day because there was an influenza challenge. So people make decisions for different ways, and we have tried to do that. And the decisions may vary based on your status, whether you are susceptible, whether you are infectious. And then what we have done is to use some dynamic stochastic programming where you put a finite time horizon, and then individuals make decisions based presumably on avoiding infection at some fixed time horizon or some other objective function. And then what you do is they make the decisions, and then you update the epidemic, which they will be at the population level, extend the time horizon and continue to do that. And what you find in that case is typically you get much more smaller epidemics. And in fact, the invasive reproductive number or the effective reproductive number is a lot smaller than others. And there is a paper that appeared in PNS with that was led by Eli that you can see. But here I'm going to just show you a little example of something associated with behavior. And this is, you can think of this as Ebola or leprosy. So you hear, these are the special express of disease. Special express of disease would be applicable to, in this context, to leprosy or Ebola. But in this case, you have the I1 class infectious but doesn't have symptoms. The I2 class have symptoms. And what you see as people start having severe symptoms, this is a phenomenological model. This is not a mechanistic model, but you can actually do it in other ways that it is mechanistic, but the questions get more complicated. Then what you see is as the number of I2 people increase, then essentially the infection rate decreases. And if you do that, then in this particular model, you can show that this model supports diffusive instability, and in fact, you generate patterns where people tend to aggregate according to whether they are not infected or not infected. Okay, so this is what you would expect. Yes. Yeah, there are three diffusion coefficients, DS, DI, 1, and... in the conditions that you have then in the simulations, I just indicated it then. This is fast aggregation. Some diffusion coefficients are more larger than others, some are smaller than others. These are constant coefficients, yes.
Right, is what is meant in the previous slide that if those conditions are met, that there are diffusion coefficients that will give rise to...
Yes.
Right, it's not that those conditions...
No. But you actually meet the conditions for some coefficients.
Correct.
I thought he was reading his email. Okay. No, that's good. Anyway, let me talk a little bit about Ebola. Okay, so the interesting thing, I run a summer program for 20 years, and undergraduates and now many graduate students, they come and they choose the questions. In 1996, some people study Ebola, and you had seen the 180 or almost 200 technical reports, but they study Ebola. 1999, they study Ebola. I didn't know really anything about Ebola, and they computed the basic reproductive number and eventually translated in this value. There was a value of about 2. Now that highly cited paper went because it was probably the only one that had computed Ebola at that point. And essentially, what we know is everybody knows the situation in West Africa, porous borders, terrible health conditions. And the students came to my office and said, well, let's write something about this. And essentially, this is all the data that one had. In fact, at the time that we started working on this, might have been around September 11. So we have very little data. So we then submitted a paper, and essentially we did this in SARS. Well, the ongoing epidemic was in Toronto, and I was at Los Alamos, it was 2003. We looked at the SARS epidemic, and then we make a prediction that there will be no more than 400 cases, and there were 396 cases, and I remember it appears first in the Washington Post, and then later on in a journal. So it was interesting. This is the first time that it was accepted in the Washington Post before than any journal. Anyway, but so this had this idea, and I said, okay, well, you do what you have to do. You compute the basic reproductive number, and you try to estimate this. And eventually, we wrote a paper that appear in September 18. It was submitted about a week before. But the general idea is we predicted that there would not, by the end of September, there would be no more than 7,000 cases, and there was the number of cases. So there was an article, for example, here that appeared in some papers actually appeared, where the CDC predicted 500,000 cases by January. I could not understand how that prediction came about. And they note in this same article that, by the way, these crazy people in Arizona State and my former student at Harvard, they predict 6,800 cases. Who can be right? Okay. But what was different about this? It was not that you computed the basic reproductive number. It's the fact that as an epidemic goes, you expect the rate of exponential growth to decrease. And in this case, we were looking at that, and that's called the effective reproductive number starts to going down and down. What we found that in this particular case is that it was increasing. It was not decreasing, but it was actually increasing. And in fact, that worried us because we had predicted less cases than 7,000, but this actually makes us to make a bigger prediction. And the general idea is when we look at the data, we in fact could do some statistical tests and show that the basic reproductive number was actually increasing. What it turned out to be, and we have done later some studies about this, is that in some of the towns where they have Ebola, the army came, surrounded the town, and they didn't let anybody out. Right? So in fact, people were without terrible medical facilities, with no place to isolate people, to be together, and in fact, they increased the likelihood that they will generate secondary cases, and in fact, you saw further infections. Another of my students, he just wrote a cancer paper on PNS, I'm not involved in that. I don't know too much about cancer, but he's involved in that. But he also came, and he was very, very interested on the role of technology on Ebola transmission. So he had some ideas, and he wrote a paper, and I worked with him. But his basic is we have PCR tests, initially, when people get infected with almost any disease, certainly with Ebola, it's not detectable. Eventually, there is a time that it becomes detectable. And in the case of Ebola, it becomes detectable before you have symptoms. So that's the general idea. So in this particular case, that's what they did. So they look at 20 people that have been exposed to Ebola, 24 that have been exposed to the Ebola, and then 11 of them of those actually developed Ebola symptoms, and of those, 7 of them were predicted to have Ebola using the PCR test. So it looked like technology was going to be useful. So he wrote a simple model that you have where you have susceptibles, latent undetectable, latent detectable, infectious, hospitalized, death, all the compartments that you need, you write a single outbreak model, and then you study that, and then here in the x-axis, you did the proportion of individuals diagnosed before symptoms. So you can see we only went to 50%. Some of this is going to appear in the notices of the MS, and they were, they said, why don't you do it to 100%? They said, because we just can't go to 50% because that makes the point, okay? But and in fact, it makes the point. But the big point is the red line on the top. It says that if the effectiveness of isolation is 50%, it doesn't really matter how well you detect people. So in other words, if you don't have the public health infrastructure to isolate people and to take care of people, it doesn't matter whether you are capable to diagnose them before they have symptoms. In some sense, you are not going to be able to stop the ebola epidemic. So that was the case of that. OK, so now we go to influenza. And very clever disease. I've been working on influenza since 1985 when I was Simon's postdoc. He introduced me to influenza. And I told him I was not going to study epidemics, and I'm stuck with epidemics ever since. And the point is that, influenza is very smart. When the trade from Russian Empire came to Western Europe, it followed the trade. Then trains were invented, so it climbed the trains, very clever guy. And then later on, by the way, when it came to the trains, eventually there was some Soviet scientists, Rabachev and Barojan, that in fact developed very good models that predicted the spread of influenza at that point. And in fact, there was a letter that I don't think was published that the former Jean Jacquet, former editor of the Mad Bio Science, had told me, where in fact he was very, very worried about the ability to transmit influenza via modes of transportation. And he was very worried that it might be used for biological deliver and release of biological agents. So then it comes the time of airplanes, and it spreads to airplanes. But then, as has been mentioned below, and this is where a lot of the work that I did in 85 and through the 90s, and what we did is we developed a theory of cross immunity in the following sense. Here, you see a strain of influenza, and essentially you can think of the United States as a big superorganism, and there are some areas that it had depleted most of the susceptibles, so there are no longer enough susceptibles. And if a new strain of influenza comes the next year, as long as this strain of influenza has some relationship to the previous one, and there is a whole theory about that and many studies about that, and it's not that difficult to understand, but there's a lot of that, then it better use a different route, because otherwise it's going to die in the process. So if you see this is 67, then you see 68 is a related strain, and it follows a different path, right? So essentially what we did is we developed some models, H-structure models, for the spread of influenza. We have two strains, and H-structure has some sort of delayed effect. So it produced an epidemic that essentially is a damp oscillator. So you have two strains. You have one that produces some sort of damp oscillator. The other produces another damp oscillator. And cross immunity, which essentially reduces the transmissibility of one strain over people that already had the previous strain, right? Essentially couples these two weakly coupled oscillators. And based on how strong or weakly this coupling takes place, you can prove the appearance or reappearance of influenza every 20 years, or you can prove the existence of multiple stress influenza going off for periods of 2 or 3 years. And we published this in 1989 and a few years later. OK. This is the issue of bad waves. I love mathematics, but the mathematics often are, we get in love with the mathematics about, and then we want to use it in areas where maybe we have to think about something else. So we look at this data, and people talk about waves. This is look like a wave, influenza wave. Writing people a lot of papers, and they write spatiotemporal dynamics of influenza. And it sounds right. And I know, for example, when you study measles in London in the 2 or 3 centuries ago, it was special because people actually move, and very little. When I went to Britain first time in the 1990s, I knew some people that they have never visited London, for example. So, but influenza is a little bit, and just to show what is the case, this is the influenza pandemic in Mexico. So you're gonna see it appear in Mexico very quickly, and then instantly into the United States in Canada, right? And then you look at that, more Canada, and eventually South America, and eventually goes to Europe. We cannot model this as a diffusion process, reaction diffusion process with partial differential code. It just doesn't work that way. So it gets more complicated. It is true that once it arrives in some places, maybe locally, it has a diffusion process, but it spreads like wildfires. So one has to do a different way. One, essentially, these are epidemics driven by transportation systems. So my general idea with this previous data, and I have to go to this, is can I explain this data using transportation systems, okay? So I did a map of Mexico. This is the most important city in the world. And then you see Tlaxcala, so you want to go to San Luis Potosí, you go to the south part of Mexico, and then you jump into the subway that transports 6 million people a day, go to another terminal, and then you go to the other one. And we had data on all the transportation systems and the flow of traffic in and out of Mexico City this way. And then we essentially follow some of the ideas that in some sense were embedded in the world of Baroyan and Rabachev, Rabachev and Longini, Arino did some beautiful work in air transportation models that did that. Hyman and LaForce also did some work connecting influenza different cities. And the model is more or less something like this. You have, in this case, 32 states, and within each state you can put within class dynamics, which just means the standard epidemiological model. Then you put the transportation system that allows you, but it has to be weighted by the strength of the interaction, and it has to be weighted by population density. Okay, and then we put vaccination, because at that time when we were doing this model, vaccination was still a possibility. Canada had twice as much vaccinations as they needed, and when they noticed that, they sold it to Mexico, and Mexico bought it when the epidemic was over. I still can't figure that out. But and then they were trying to force people to get vaccinated, because nobody said, why should I vaccinate? The epidemic is over. But that's the model that we have. And in this particular case, this is the pandemic that we have. And the back of the matter is that you see the data here. These are 3 days, which you won't be able to see. June 4, 2009, September 5, 2009, and January 4. And you can see the different state contributions. So in the bottom is the name of the states and how they contributed differentially to the number of reported cases. But of course, there are population density differences and things like that. And in fact, this is the population density differences. And here you can see, for example, this is what we call the weakly connected states, and I'll explain why. And these are their densities, this is the strongly connected states. There is some confusion here. For example, this one and this one is essentially just Mexico City, or greater Mexico City is 22 million. And we actually did that, and then what we divided the map based upon the traffic in weakly and strongly connected states. So these were the weakly connected states, these were the strongly connected states. And this was data that had been obtained over many years by a Mexican anthropologist, very well known, Acuña Soto, which has been studying the death records and finding out where occurred the largest number of pneumonia deaths. And based on the largest number of pneumonia deaths, he defined this as the influenza corridor. So they defined that as the influenza corridor. And it's very interesting that at least today it correlates strongly with the strongly connected states. So we can write equations, and Q would be the relative contribution of the strong connected states to the total daily flow into new cases. And this is how we connected them. I'm not going to go into that anymore. And the question is, can we generate that pattern that we see? And we try. And this is the best that we could. This is the contribution due to the strongly connected states. This is weakly connected states. We can generate that pattern, okay? So then we remember that they actually did something, right? So there were interventions. So on April 30, they closed the schools. Professional football stadiums were empty while they played matches of soccer. Mexico was the cleanest city in the world. In fact, I think the Mexican government actually acted superbly for this epidemic. You know, very, very different than what has happened in other epidemics. They actually acted extremely well. And both political parties did an extraordinary job at really taking precautions. The biggest problem that they had later on is that it was not a severe pandemic. And then people were disappointed. They said, why would you be disappointed? We should be happy that, you know, we didn't see a massive number of cases. Now, here is when the summer starts, so people leave schools, and here is when school starts again. So what we say, can we actually put that, and we put that in some sort of transmission model here. So in the top part, you can see is the transmission at the beginning, those sort of the strongest transmission, that's all more or less related to R0. And then when they close, it goes down. And then as people see over several weeks that it's not as severe, they start to coming back and opening restaurants and doing that. Then comes the summer, it goes down, and then it goes down for a while because of the summer, and then the school starts and go on different levels. And if you do that, then you start getting patterns like this, which is exactly three waves, where the dots represent the contribution of the weakly connected states, the other one, the strongly connected states. And in the first case, Mexico City dominates, then the weakly connected states, and then its contributions of both of them, and that's where you can actually generate that pattern. Okay, I've been working a lot with contacts, and I have some issues related to contacts. I've written a lot of papers, but the biggest, conceptually, this idea that people transmit diseases via contacts makes a lot of sense. The problem is, how do you measure contacts? So I put here some slides so that people can help me understand, okay? I would like to know what is the average number of contacts each person has per unit time there or here. And the point is, we can't. And there are data, and there are studies, and people use them. I'm using them to feed models, and we have no idea. What I do know, if I spend several hours there, I'm going to get something. And if I spend half an hour, maybe not, right? So we can actually characterize environments by risk. And depends how much time you spend in that environment, right? The risk that the most likely that you will catch a disease. And this has been used before to the study of tuberculosis. When they have tuberculosis patients, they used to put a guinea pig on their hospital rooms. And then they waited to see how long it took the guinea pig to get tuberculosis. So these are actually measures. So what we have done, tried to do, rather than using an Eulerian approach, like looking at molecules, that you move individuals from one pie and then they mix, and then you lose track of individuals, essentially. We try to use some sort of Lagrangian approach. So let me explain it better in the next figure, because otherwise I don't have time. So what you have here in two patches, you have that you maintain the residency identity of each individual. And essentially, you don't really model the movement explicitly, but in the other hand, you do. So you define a matrix of residence times P, and then P12 is the time that a resident individual of patch 1 spends in patch 2, and this is the amount of time that a resident of patch 2 spends in patch 1. And you can fill in the other ones. This is a smart audience, so you don't have to blend anymore. So thus, you can do that, and you can write models like that. So here I use the SIS model just to make it simple, but this is not really the best one. So you can see here, births, deaths, recovery, and here your SI infected in patch J, right? And in patch J, it could be infected by a resident from his patch that is visiting there, right? Or by a resident dot patch that it happens to be in his residence place. And in based upon that, you can see what is the total affected population of patch J. You have to weight it by the times there. What is the proportion of infected of patch J that's there? And what is actually the proportion of infected populations on patch J, right? So for example, when I went to South Africa and you visit Johannesburg or Soweto, you were in Soweto on a work day, most of the people from Soweto go to work to Johannesburg because there is no place to work in Soweto, right? So what is the effective population size of Johannesburg? It's not the census data. It is the population that were there plus, right, the visitors that come from Soweto to work there every day. And you can write models like that, and you can write nonlinearities like that. In addition, beta, we consider now a transmission, a risk parameter. So we say, this area is riskier than this area for whatever information that you have, and they have some sort of a ranking, and we forget about contacts. Okay, and based upon that, you can compute, this is, I don't know, but sometimes latent, putting this in latent, and this is always complicated. PowerPoint is easy, you just cut and put it there. But anyway, you put it here, and you can compute the basic reproductive number as a function of the residence time matrix, and you can actually do that. And then you can use also patch-specific reproductive numbers. So for example, you have the beta j over beta I, and there are different cases based on whether all the patches are connected or whether they are not totally connected. And if they are not all totally connected, for example, this beta j over beta I, if it is large, it would mean in some sense that this is a source and this is a sink. And you can study different structures associated with that, and you can actually study epidemics this way. Okay, so now a quick example where you have three patches, and now I put vectors to make it more interesting, okay? Okay, so we have that. So you can also do this. But in this case, we got lazy vectors. They don't travel long distances, so they are resonant to the patches to make it less complicated. And for some diseases, they work there. You can write the equations. If you do it simply enough, you can simplify the equations, and you can compute the basic reproductive number for this complicated model, but it's not really that complicated anymore. And if it is totally connected, you have the usual story. If this ugly R0 is greater than 1, then you have an endemic state. The vector and the host live together. Otherwise, the disease disappears. If they are totally connected, if they are not totally connected, different things can happen. And then here you have three patches. And now we study the dynamics of disease based on the mobility of these patches. So what we assume is that well, I guess actually in this case, those are the assumptions. But obviously, this is the riskier patch, less risky patch, and less risky patch. And you see the mobility in red is when they don't move. I can see very well. Anyway, and as you increase the values, there is more mobility. And you can see just that you generate more cases in the other if there is some mobility. And in this, in the less risky patch, you will have less due to the mobility. And the question whether there is a critical mobility level that would actually diminish or increase that. And I will get into that. Also, in the case that they are not totally connected, in some patches it might disappear. So you have those situations. So now, finally, I'm going to talk about Zika, because I've been in El Salvador. And actually, we just submitted a paper that we actually estimated the value of Zika using data from Barranquilla. So it's approximately between 1.7 and almost 3, depends. So it's actually quite high. But on the other hand, it might be that the sample of the population that first get it might be a particular special. It might not be representative of the whole population. So I'm not completely sure about that. But this is the, so now you have the vectors, and now the hosts have a more complicated story, susceptible, latent, infected. And this is important, asymptomatic and symptomatic. Because in the case of Ebola, of Zika, about 80% of the people have no symptoms. And this is the resident time matrix. So we have two patches. So we're going to have two patches. So we have these conditions there. And now what we're going to do, I'm interested in looking at this in the process of El Salvador. And the process of El Salvador is that there are some neighborhoods totally dominated by gangs, where nobody can really enter and provide any kind of vector control. They cannot even go to vaccinate people. I mean, this is just how complicated. So in this case, we look at variations in population size. So the neighborhood that had the good system had 1,000 people or something like that, and the others kept just changing the values. And in this case, we assume that the people from the neighborhood with good services moved very little to the other pass. We fix that, and then we start changing the other. And this is the final epidemic size. So you can see if there is a lot of mobility, then this you have the bigger final epidemic size. But also if there is a lot of mobility, right, you have the smallest global reproductive number. So it's almost look like a contradiction, but that's the way it happens. We can do this again, also final size. And in this case, we look at the case where I think they have the same population size. Here we're using a different reproductive number, 1.5. In the previous one, we were using a reproductive number of 3. So you see the same pattern, but lower levels. the same patterns for lower levels. So in some sense, yes, you have a lower reproductive number, you have less cases, but you still have a serious problem as long as you have this heterogeneity in places. And in this case, what happens when they actually have the same size, both neighborhoods, when there was no difference in densities for different R0s, and you can see you can almost get rid of that if there was more mobility. And in this case, we actually study also R0 as a function of the ratios. You have and the mobility, and we study this different case. And essentially, you always see this structure. How do we compute the global reproductive number? We solve those systems of equations for the, and we actually computed the dominant eigenvalue, and we actually did it this way. Okay, so that we put this on this table where you have high mobility, low mobility. Remember, the people in the affluent neighborhood move very little to the other side, and you can also see what are the minimums are zeros and what is the general idea. But in general, you cannot get rid of Zika this way. You always have a very, very serious problem this way. But of course, that means you have to do other things. The most important really is, I think at this moment, is vector control, whether the release of genetically modified mosquitoes works, or whether you actually implement some solid vector control measure. Now, vector control measures are really critically important because the vector for Zika is the vector for chikungunya, is the vector for dengue, is the vector for yellow fever, is the vector for malaria. So anybody that knows a little bit about life history dynamics, you have to go there, and if you want to control that, you want to control the larva. So that's the most critical problem. It's not really so much disease-oriented, although there are other vectors, but essentially controlling the vector population, it is absolutely critical. Okay, finally, we wrote a paper about what have we learned about the Ebola epidemic, so let me put some conclusions here. The cost of managing an infectious disease outbreaks is always greater than the cost of avoiding them, right? We have lots of experience, right? SARS is a good example, right? And there will be more. So we will always react, and we react is more costly. The cost of disease emergence will continue to rise. I think the Ebola epidemic, it will cost a lot more than the SARS epidemic, but by a huge factor, at least probably a factor of maybe 5, if not 10. So that's one of the general ideas that we have. So we need more cost-effective ways of responding than the current approach of responding to outbreaks. And we all know that. Let me see what is another things. Now, targeted programs of behavior change are really important. But this has, now I'm going to try to speak as an economist, I see. Focusing on incentives for bushmeat hunting is very important. Programs designed to reduce the consumption of primates found dead in forests. I mean, we have to provide these individuals alternatives if we want to avoid that. And then projects aim to reduce dependency on bushmeat, that also very critical, right? Farming of some wildlife over expansion of livestock production, but always trying to put, in particular in these hotspots, some surveillance of biosecurity measures so that we can detect potential future pathogens. If there is a vaccine, right, then how do you distribute the vaccine is important. In Ebola, it's transmitted in hospitals. Well, sort of pre-vaccinating people that work in hospitals would be obvious. And then the targeted training, the infection control, and efforts to maintain surge capacity is important. There has to be a workforce ready to react if we have these cases, and there have to be very facilities. The global mitigation of future pandemics, which is one of the most interesting, well, depends on many factors, right? And one has to be ready to identify hotspots and to identify which is more or less where most of the novel diseases appear. And when, in fact, we have a lot of knowledge that has been gathered by ecologists and entomologists, and essentially we know where are the hotspots and where most likely things are to take place, and we need to phone and approve that. And then an improved understanding of the liability for disease emergence will drive this change when all are at risk. Collective action is needed to strengthen the weakest links of the chain, and we are all at risk. So thank you. Okay.